Hello student, welcome to one more session of Computer Network and Security. This is Vasant Naik from Canara Engineering College. Today we will start module 3 of 18CS52. According to the syllabus set by the university, module 3 it starts from 4.3 section 4.3 to 4.7. So here we are going to discuss router, the architecture of router and switch. Then the protocol, that is internet protocol, that is a network layer protocol, IP version 4, IP version 6, and internet control messaging protocol. Other than that, we will discuss different types of routing algorithms like link state and distance vector, and routing information protocol, open state forward path protocol, then border gateway protocol. All those protocols we are going to discuss here. So before discussing all those things, we need to have a brief introduction about network layer. So in my previous session, I have already discussed there are two types of model for network design. One is called as DoD model, department designed by Department of Defense US. Second one is OSI model, Open System Interconnect. Open System Interconnect model has got 7 layers. DoD model or TCP model got 5 layers. So with reference to TCP model or DoD model, so network layer is the third layer. First layer is the application from the this one upper side. Second layer is the transport. Third layer is the network or internet. Fourth layer is the data link. And fifth one is the last one is the physical layer. So what is the function of the network layer? Actually, the function of the network layer is routing and logical addressing. Routing means sending packet from one network to the other. And logical addressing means each machine on the network is identified by one address, that is called as logical address. Without logical address, this address, it is not possible to communicate with the machine on the network. So that is the main function of network layer. Now in the scenario shown here, host 1 wants to send a certain information to host 2. Host 1 wants to send information to host 2. Host 2 is connected to separate network and host 1 is connected to separate network. I have marked the host 1 and host 2 and corresponding router 1 and router 2. That means host 1 is attached to router 1 and host 2 is attached to router 2. Now, so this shows simple network with the two hosts, H1 and H2, and in between several routers on the path between H1 and H2. Suppose we imagine H1 is sending information to H2, that is H1 is sending information to H2, and we will consider the role of network layer. What is the role of network layer when H1 sends the information to H2? So here network layer in H1 takes segments from the transport layer in H1. Network layer in H1 takes a segment from the transport layer in H1, encapsulates each segment into the datagram, then sends the datagram to the nearby router. So which is the nearby router for H1? H1 is connected to gateway R1. So H1 forwards the datagram to the R1. At the receiving end, H2 gets the datagram from R2. So at the receiving end, receiving host H2, the network layer receives the datagram from the nearby router, that is R2, and extract the transport layer segment, and delivers the transport layer data to the transport layer, then to the application layer. So here the primary role of the router is to forward the datagram from input link to the output link. We'll see that later. So network layer protocols run on every host and every router. So we'll see this one. So we'll see now how the packet moves from the host 1 to host 2. actually the packet from the transport layer of host 1 moves to the network layer, and from network layer to the through the physical layer to the router R1. So in between it will take a different path to reach the H2. You can see here exactly. So the packet travels through the different path to ultimately to reach a H2. Now in the diagram, so the routers are shown with the truncated protocol stack. Truncated protocol stack means with no upper layers above the network layer, because it is assumed that except for control purpose, routers don't run except for control purpose. It is not assumed, it is actually except for control purpose, router don't run application and transport layer protocols. So here in the in between router, you will not see transport layer protocols and application layer protocols. It is a truncated protocol, that is physical, data link and network. Only three layers are visible because router will not run either transport layer protocols or application layer protocols. Application layer protocols. Now student will see now what is the difference between forwarding and routing. Forwarding means moving packets from router's input to the appropriate router output. Routing determines the route taken by the packet from source to destination. This is the definition, forwarding and routing. Let me explain what is forwarding. When a packet arrives at the router input link, the router must move the packet to the appropriate output link. For example, in the previous diagram, let me take you to the previous diagram. Here in this diagram, when the packet arrives in this network, router will forward that packet from the input link to the output link. Similarly, from here there are several routers are there, but router will decide through which interface it has to forward the packet. But on the other hand, what is a routing? So routing is something like network layer must determine the route or path taken by the packet as they flow from sender to receiver. Network layer has to decide. For example, here the packet can take different path, but network layer has to decide the best path to reach the destination. That is called as a routing. So algorithms calculates this path referred. So every router has got routing algorithm that calculates this path, and that is referred as a routing algorithm. So once again, forwarding refers to the router's local action of transmitting a packet from input link to the appropriate output link interface. But routing refers to the network-wide process that determines the end-to-end path. So you have to remember here, the routing refers to the network-wide process that determine the end-to-end path that takes the packet from the source to destination. So that is the difference between forwarding and routing. Now each router has got something called as a forwarding table or a routing table. Each router has got some forwarding table or routing table that is calculated by the routing algorithm. So you can see here the forwarding table of a particular router. So as soon as the packet comes, each router will examine the IP header field of the packet. Based on the value of the IP header field, it will cross check that value with the forwarding table, and based on the forwarding table index, it will forward the packet to the appropriate output. So, or appropriate interface. For example, in this case, the packet contains the value, that is value 3. So, router will refer the forwarding table, and the forwarding table, it will index to interface 2. This value is indexed to interface 2. So, router will forward the packet through the interface 2 to the other router. That is called as next off router. So So here the main role of the routing algorithm is to decide the values are inserted into the router's forwarding table. That means router's forwarding table or routing table is calculated by the routing algorithm which runs on the particular router. For example, there are different types of routing algorithms will run, whether it is a distance vector or a link state vector. Based on that, different algorithms may run on the router. So all those algorithms will communicate with the nearby router and will compute the routing table. And this routing table is also called as a forwarding table. Transport layer provides two types of services, that is connection-oriented service and connection-less service. So connection-oriented services are referred as virtual circuit. I'm sorry, the network layer provides two types of service. Even the transport layer also provides two types of service, connection-oriented service and connection-less service. So in network layer, the connection-oriented service is called as virtual circuit. That provides network layer connection service. And connection-less service is called as datagram service. Connection-less service is called as a datagram service. Now, what is the difference between, first of all, datagram service and virtual circuit service, and how it is analogous to transport layer protocol or transport layer service? Because we know transport layer also provides same type of service like connection oriented service and connectionless service. Now we have to see, because network layer connection and connectionless service have some parallel with transport layer connection oriented and connectionless service. That's why you need to understand the difference between connection oriented service and connectionless service of transport layer and network layer. So in the network layer, these services are host-to-host service provided by the in the network layer these services are host-to-host service provided by the network layer for the transport layer. In the same way, if we consider the transport layer connection-oriented service or connection-less service, then these services are process-to-process service provided by the transport layer for the application layer. So transport layer provides process-to-process connection-oriented connection-less service for application layer. Network layer provides a service for a transport layer. That is the difference. So here you can see the network layers provide service for a transport layer. So service is host to host service. And here one point you should remember, like it cannot run both service simultaneously. So network layer cannot run connection oriented service and connectionless service simultaneously. And this network oriented services are implemented in core network. Core network is like not end system. Core network means router. So, but in our transport layer provides process to process service, and it runs on the end system. And one more thing is, transport layer can run both connection oriented service and connectionless service simultaneously. So students, as I said, there are two types of services provided by the network. One is connection oriented service, that is called a virtual circuit, and second one is connection less service, that is called as a datagram service. We are not going to going in detail related to these services, but here one thing you have to remember: what is a virtual circuit connection? Virtual circuit connection means network router maintain the connection state information for the ongoing connection. In virtual circuit, it will network layer maintain the connection information for the ongoing connection. So here, before data transfer, virtual circuit has to be established by the process like call setup, tear down for each call before the data can flow. So here packet carries some identification, packet identifier, that is called as a virtual circuit identifier. So each router between the source to destination path maintain the state of the connection. So you can see here, so virtual circuit implementation consists of path from source to destination, virtual circuit numbers, and the forwarding table. Forwarding table looks like this. Each router will maintain the forwarding table looks like this. So we will not go in detail. Now you see just this virtual circuits signaling, virtual circuits protocols are used in different topology like ATM, frame relay, X.25, all these topology Our network architectures makes use of virtual circuits, but our internet or TCP makes use of that is a datagram service, not virtual circuit service. So here you can see how the virtual circuit works exactly. So it will initiate the call, and after that, first it will initiate the call from between two network layers of two network layer between two routers, you can see, and each router will maintain the virtual circuit information. Here we are talking with respect to router connection, not with respect to end-to-end system, not with respect to end-to-end system. So in this way, call is initiated. Then after that, data transfer takes place. So after that, call termination take place. But in datagram network, you can see here, datagram, there is no initial call establishment, but its packets are dumped into the network, and each packet can take its own path. Here you can see some packet will travel like this, some packet will travel like this, until it reaches the destination. So that is about a datagram network. Now students will see now the architecture of the router. So what is there inside the router? So the topic is router architecture overview. So the main two function of the router is to run the routing algorithm. So there are two types of algorithm, distance vector and link state. So based on that algorithms, different types of algorithms are RIP, OSPF, BGP, etc. Then router has to calculate the routing table. So that is also called as a forwarding table, to forward the datagram from the incoming to the outgoing link. So the main components of the routers are, one is input port, other one is output port, third one is input port and output port. So you see here the input port and output port, then high speed switching fabric, both input port and output ports are connected to high speed switching fabric, then routing processor. Now this section of the router is called as forwarding data plane, and this section of the router is called as control plane. This is a control plane and this is the forwarding data plane. What is the job of the control plane? The job of the control plane is routing and management and other functions. All those are implemented by software. This section of the router is implemented by hardware. This is called as a forwarding data plane, and this is called as a control plane. So now we'll see what is the function of input port and router output port. Actually, this is the input port here. You see, a input port performs several key functions. Main three functions are something like this. So here in the diagram, this box performs certain function, this box performs certain function, and this box performs certain function. We will see one by one. So main thing, the input port performs physical layer function of terminating incoming physical layer at the router. This is shown by the rightmost box of the output, input port. What is the main function of the input port is, it will terminate the incoming signal. Second one is a input port performs a link layer function, that is data link layer related functions. Input layer, that is represented in this diagram by this box. And the third one is, it also performs a lookup, that is a forwarding table functions, lookup functions or forwarding table. That means in order to forward the packet from the input port to the corresponding output port, it has to do the lookup task. Lookup task means referring the routing table created by the routing processor. So that is the main job of the input port. Second one is switching fabric. So switching fabric, what it will do is it will connect router's input port to the output port. So it is, this is contained completely within the router, and it is made by of hardware components. Third one is the output port. As we explained in the input port, output port also performs several functions. One is terminating the link. Second one is mapping the input port to the output port, or output port to the input port. Like data link layer functions and physical layer functions. All these are performed by output port. Third one is the routing processor. Now, what is the task of the routing processor? The task of the routing processor is to compute routing table. So on the router, different types of routing protocols runs. Based on the routing protocols, routing processor will compute a routing table. Routing table is the table which gives the to which output port the packet has to be forwarded. Which output port the packet has to be forwarded in order to achieve shortest route from source to destination. That is done by routing processor. So as I explained earlier, so entire this routing architectures are divided into two sections. That is called as forwarding data plane, and second one is the control plane. The main job of the control plane is the routing and management, that is implemented by using software. Then the main job of the forwarding data plane is forwarding the packet from input port to the output port, that is implemented by hardware. So this diagram explains the input port functions. So input port functions, as I explained, it normally performs three type of functions. One is line termination. It will terminate the incoming lines. So this is especially related to physical layer protocol or physical layer implementation or physical layer protocol. Then the second section or second function of the input port is link layer protocol related function, that is data link layer protocol. So we have already studied data link layer protocol such as Ethernet 802.3, carrier sense multiple access, carrier sense multiple access collision detection. All these functions functions are implemented here. Next one is routing table lookup. So the three main functions executed by input port is line termination, data link layer protocol, and forward lookup means lookup table. Based on the lookup table, it will forward the packet. So in order to forward the packet, it will queue the packet in queuing system. All these things are implemented here. So from here, the packet moves to the switching fabric. From the switching fabric, the packet moves to the output port. So students, we see now the main function of the switching fabrics and what are the different types of switching fabrics. Actually, switching fabrics transfers the packet from the input buffer to the appropriate output buffer, and that is also measured in terms of switching rate, the rate at which packet can be transferred from input to the output. There are three types of three types of switching fabrics are there. One is memory, second one is a bus, third one is called as a crossbar. First one is called as a memory, second one is called as a bus, third one is called as a crossbar. Now what is a switching via memory? switching via memory is the simplest and earliest method. The earliest routers were like traditional computers with switching between input and output ports being done under the direct control of this one processor. So here input and output port function as a traditional input and output device like in our normal computer with the operating system. A input port with an arriving packet first signaled to the routing processor via interrupt. We know this one. The packet was then copied from the input port to the processor memory. Then the routing processor then extract the destination address from the header by means of lookup and pass the packet to the appropriate output port according to the forwarding table and copy the packet to the output port's buffer. So many modern router makes use of switch via memory. The second case is switching via bus. So this is the second case, switching via bus. In this approach, an input port transfers the packet directly from the input to the output over the shared bus. Without the intervention of the processor. Only the disadvantage of this the technology is when multiple packet comes from the multiple input port, then it has to wait in the queue because only one packet can move in the bus. Because only one packet can move cross the bus at a time. Only one packet will cross the bus at a time. So that's why if the multiple packet arrives from the different port, for example, here in the diagram you can see, if the multiple packets arrives and from the different port and it has to go through this port, then it has to wait till its turn comes. That is the one thing you have to remember here. The next one is the next type of this one is called as a crossbar. The third one is switching via interconnection network. That is nothing but a crossbar. Here, this is used to overcome the bandwidth limitation of a single or shared bus. This is the memory or shared bus. Here the main drawback is bandwidth limitation. To use more sophisticated interconnection in the internet, this can be overcome by the crossbar type. Here, a crossbar switch is an interconnection network. It is an interconnection network of consists of like 2n buses that connect n input port and n output port. Here it contains 2n buses. So it contains 2n buses that connects n input port and n output port by means of interconnection. Here you can see by means of interconnection. Suppose when a packet arrives at port A from port A, for example, the packet arrives from port A. Suppose this packet arrives from port A and wants to move to the port Y. The switch controller close the cross point at the intersection of bus A and Y. And port A, then the port A sends the packet into the bus which is picked up by the Y bus. So in this way, this works, crossbar works. So there are three types of switching fabrics. One is called as a memory, second one is called as a bus, third one is called as a crossbar. The disadvantage is sharing of the bandwidth. So in order to overcome this one, we are using the third one, that is called as a crossbar. So as I explained earlier, the first generation of routers normally use like switch via memory technique. So you can see here the animation of that one. So as soon as the packet comes, the packet will be stored in the memory, and it will packet will be monitored by the lookup table. Then packet will be sent to the output port, which works like a traditional computer. But we have one more technique, that is switching via bus. The mains here, the input and output port will share the common bus. But here the bus contention is the main problem. That is, the switching speed is limited by the bus bandwidth. So to overcome that one, we have one more thing that is called as a crossbar technique. So other than that, now we'll move to the output port. The main function of the output port is, you can see here, that is called as a buffering. Why buffering is required? Buffering is required when datagram arrives from the fabric faster than the transmission rate. When the transmission rate throttles, then it is necessary to save the copy of the packet in the buffer. That is done by the buffering stage. You can see here. Second function of the output port is scheduling. So here, output port will schedule the packet so that the packet reaches the destination properly. Because datagram packet can be lost due to the congestion or lack of buffers. So in order to avoid the congestion, it has to schedule the datagram, and it has to store the datagram in the packet. The main function of the scheduling is to give the priority, so that because TCP in internet, there are different TCP flows are there, each flow should get equal priority. So in order to give the equal priority, scheduling is performed. So here you can see how the output port buffer the packet, and how it will switch the packet to the output. Here you can see in the diagram, when the packet comes from the input port, the packet is mapped to the output port. For example, here the packet with the red color is mapped to this port. Similarly, the packet may come from the other input port also, but all these packets will be buffered. All this packet will be buffered because the output the output port has to send the packet one by one. So it will buffer the packet, and it will give the priority to the packet while moving the packet to the output port. So we know, irrespective of the buffers, there is always a queuing delay and loss due to the improper or due to the insufficient buffer. So the insufficient buffer is called as also buffer flow. So buffer overflow. So here, sometimes queued datagram at the front of the queue prevents the others in the queue from moving forward. For example, here two packets are there, which is in red color. So here buffer is not empty, so these two packets cannot be moved or forwarded to the output port because the buffer is not empty. So if it is forwarded, then the packet will be lost. In that case, the other packet has to wait, and that the other packet has to wait because of this packet. So here you can see the blue packet cannot move to this port, and green packet cannot move through this port, even though those ports are free. Even though the buffers in those ports are free, these packets cannot move. So that is the problem in the queuing, and that is called as end of line, HOL blocking. So what is end of line HOL blocking is, a queue datagram at front of the queues prevents the others in the queue moving forward. So that is called as a end of line blocking. So you can same thing you can see here. So with this we have completed the introduction to router architecture and router. So in the next session, we'll see what is internet protocol. In the internet protocol, we'll see what is a datagram, what is IP version 4, and what is ICMP and IP version 6, followed by the other topics. Thank you.